T-Tube News Today, March 24, 2022. T-Tube is created to be the voice for the voiceless. Subscribe, share, comment and press the bell sign after subscribing. News headlines. Ethiopia, airstrike on camp for displaced, likely war crime, dozens of civilians killed, injured in northern western Tigray.
Getachew Reda said the world must condemn human rights abuses in Tigray as it does in Ukraine. International solidarity with Kyiv in the face of Russian aggression is admirable. Tigrayans brutalized by Ethiopia and Eritrea deserve the same. March 23, 2022.
Chicago's diaspora communities reflect on the Tigray genocidal war. Many in the Eritrean diaspora, even those in the United States, remain fearful of speaking out against that nation's government. Simon Amman, who lives in Chicago, talks to The Weekly about the war back home by Max Blaisdell, March 23, 2022.
U.S. focused on delivery of humanitarian aid to Ethiopia's Tigray. Reuters, U.S. Special Envoy for the Horn of Africa David Satterfield told Reuters on Wednesday the top U.S. priority in the region is the delivery of humanitarian aid to Ethiopia's conflict-ravaged Tigray region, where millions are dependent on it.
Vietnam Catholics urged to pray for Ukraine. Archbishop Joseph Vu Van Thien calls on them to join Pope Francis in consecrating the world to Mary on March 25. U.S. Horn of Africa envoy visits Ethiopia as Congress drafts sanctions legislation. The State Department, meanwhile, is pursuing diplomacy to resolve the Tigray war.
Getachew Reda said the world must condemn human rights abuses in Tigray as it does in Ukraine. International solidarity with Kyiv in the face of Russian aggression is admirable. Tigrayans brutalized by Ethiopia and Eritrea deserve the same. March 23, 2022, Opinion, the unprecedented unity of the liberal democratic world against Russia's invasion of Ukraine is admirable. In addition to rallying its allies and the broader international community behind Ukraine, the United States made a powerful case against Russia in the United Nations Security Council and the UN Human Rights Council. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken excoriated Russia for its conduct in Ukraine, underscoring its flagrant violations of international law. He accused Russian forces of deliberately targeting schools, hospitals, and critical infrastructure. He also accused Russia of using euphemistic language to refer to its invasion of Ukraine. Blinken further exhorted members of the council to refrain from saying that both sides bore equal responsibility for the unprovoked attacks of one side, demanding moral clarity and unity. In praising global protests against Russia's aggression and in support of the rights of Ukraine, Blinken emphatically stated that, if we allow the rules of the international order to be flagrantly trampled anywhere, we weaken them everywhere. But this strong moral stand isn't universal. Indeed, many of the principles that Blinken enunciated regarding Russian aggression also apply perfectly to the conflict in the Ethiopian region of Tigray. Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed, Eritrean dictator Isaias Afwerki, and their ethnic Amhara expansionist partners have decimated Tigray, with the vast majority of health facilities deliberately destroyed and looted, reversing decades of progress on health care provision. The invading forces have also systematically raped women and girls, leaving them with enduring physical and psychological scars, plundered Tigray's wealth, destroyed socio-economic institutions, murdered innocent civilians, used hunger as a weapon of war to bring Tigrayans to their knees, and vandalized service-providing infrastructure. Abiy's oft-repeated narrative regarding the Tigray War is that it came about following the Tigray People's Liberation Front (TPLF) attack on units of Ethiopia's Northern Command in November 2020. However, the Northern Command incident was the beginning, not the cause, of the war. Tension between Tigray and the federal government began simmering almost as soon as Abiy assumed office in 2018, as he sought to scapegoat the TPLF for the country's various ills. Abiy saw the TPLF as a formidable counterweight to his centralizing vision, which, based as it is on a rejection of Ethiopia's fundamentally multinational nature, has since collided with Ethiopia's messy reality. When Abiy used the COVID-19 pandemic to postpone the 2020 elections in violation of the constitution, Tigray went ahead with its own regional elections. Soon thereafter, Abiy began to bring the full power of the federal government to bear on Tigray, including by suspending Tigray's federal subsidies. This vicious siege has put over 5.2 million people at risk of death by starvation. In addition to the suspension of such vital services as electricity, telecommunications, banking, and air and ground transport to and from Tigray, the Abiy regime has also persistently denied the entry of food, fuel, and medical supplies into the region, compounding the already dire humanitarian situation. What is notable is that the multifaceted humanitarian crises that normally accompany violent conflict are even starker in the case of Tigray due to the intentional destruction of its economic base and the looting of private and public wealth. The actions of the Ethiopian and Eritrean armies, as well as an assortment of ethnic Amhara paramilitary forces, combined with the persistent obstruction of humanitarian operations, have exposed virtually every Tigrayan to extreme hardship. The upshot is that Tigray is in the midst of a calamitous humanitarian crisis. The UN estimates that, to reach the millions of people in need of humanitarian assistance, 100 truckloads of supplies, food, non-food items, and fuel, must enter Tigray daily. Based on this estimate, since July 12, over 25,000 truckloads of supplies should have arrived in Tigray. In reality, according to figures provided by the UN Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs, only 1,339 trucks have arrived in Tigray, representing about 5% of the supplies required to meet increasing needs. The Abiy and Isaias regimes have left a long trail of evidence confirming their use of hunger as a tool of war. The predictable outcome of this cruelty is that thousands of Tigrayans have already perished from hunger and easily preventable diseases owing to the lack of food and life-saving medical supplies. Thousands are dying out of sight, as the consequences of the blockade of Tigray, a telecommunications blackout and fuel-related transportation problems, make it virtually impossible to send and receive timely updates on developments in hard-to-reach areas. Aside from being a violation of international law, siege starvation of civilians is also a moral abomination deserving of condemnation in the strongest terms. The UN Security Council passed a resolution condemning the weaponization of hunger in 2018. The Council's silence now in the face of brazen use of hunger as a tool of war risks irreparably undermining its credibility as a guardian of international peace and security. In contrast to Ukraine, which has justifiably commanded global attention and where concrete action has been taken by allies, the international response to the multifaceted humanitarian catastrophe in Tigray has been inadequate. Some influential personalities and opinion makers in the United States remain enamored of Abiy, presumably for his supposedly reformist agenda and commitment to liberalizing the Ethiopian economy. For instance, former U.S. Assistant Secretary of State Tibor Nagy has expressed his admiration of Abiy over his economic aims. Given Washington's long-standing stake in the expansion of liberal market economies, the core feature of the post-war liberal international order at the apex of which the United States sits, it is no surprise that Abiy continues to command a measure of loyalty from the U.S. political establishment despite his disastrous stewardship of the country. And while there is no doubt that economic liberalization is important for the United States and much of the Western world, an Ethiopia characterized by violent instability, rampant communal violence, and institutional disintegration can be of no use to anyone.
Jeffrey Feltman, a former U.S. Special Envoy for the Horn of Africa, has damagingly emphasized the democratic legitimacy of the Abiy regime, despite Abiy's jailing of nearly every viable opposition politician a year before recent elections were held. One unfortunate result has been policy incoherence. For instance, Feltman strongly condemned the devastating humanitarian blockade of Tigray, while strenuously objecting to Tigray's attempt to lift it by force. But unless the international community takes robust action to forcibly end the blockade, the people of Tigray have no alternative. Even the modicum of faith that some current and former U.S. government officials place in Abiy is hard to justify. In 2019, Abiy was awarded the prestigious Nobel Peace Prize for his apparent role in the rapprochement between Ethiopia and Eritrea, as well as for his embodiment of the desire of the international community to see a prosperous and democratic Ethiopia. A year later, he reciprocated that faith by commencing a destructive war against Tigray in concert with the Eritrean dictator. That this brutal war has been waged by these so-called peace partners is no coincidence. The peace agreement that they signed was in reality a war pact against their common enemy, the people of Tigray. Ethiopia is currently on the brink of violent disintegration, principally on account of Abiy's ill-advised declaration and prosecution of a vicious war on Tigray. At this critical juncture in Ethiopia's history, withholding punishment against the Abiy regime on the grounds that doing so would undercut his reform agenda is no longer defensible, if it ever was in the first place. In fact, the right mix of carrots and sticks to compel him to alter course is an act of mercy to spare the Ethiopian people from far worse outcomes. The Biden administration in the United States and the European Union have been admirably consistent in condemning atrocities in Tigray, but it has often been too little, too late. They have imposed sanctions, including travel bans, on Ethiopian and Eritrean officials. But even these limited sanctions have come long after both regimes have been credibly accused of committing atrocities in Tigray. For instance, Blinken used the term ethnic cleansing to refer to massive human rights violations in Western Tigray in March 2021. But such a declaration did not trigger any immediate punitive action. Consequently, atrocities against Tigrayans in Western Tigray have gotten worse since Blinken's declaration a year ago. Even Ethiopia's expulsion from the United States African Growth and Opportunity Act did not take effect until January 2022. Even with the imposition of some sanctions, the humanitarian situation in Tigray has worsened. Sanctions that do not alter a targeted regime's behavior or significantly raise the costs of its defiance are by definition inadequate. It defies logic to claim that the international community has exhausted the full range of tools at its disposal to compel the Abiy regime to facilitate unrestricted humanitarian operations. In fact, Russia and China, as Abiy's chief protectors on the UN Security Council, have rendered collective action impossible. As a result, despite the UN calling the Abiy government's expulsion of seven UN senior officials in September 2021 a violation of international law, it did not hold him accountable for it, emboldening his regime to brazenly obstruct humanitarian operations.
Although in recent weeks the regime has allowed additional UN humanitarian air service flights to Mekelle, the quantity of supplies brought in is so small that it won't begin to alleviate Tigray's catastrophic medical and humanitarian emergency. Among other things, the UN, the United States, and the EU should demand that the regime allow aid agencies to operate planes with expanded cargo capacity and work hard to make that happen. Like all initially promising leaders who ultimately disappoint their admirers, Abiy resorts to the demonization of the West at the slightest sign of critical scrutiny of his conduct of the war on Tigray. The United States in particular has been on the receiving end of organized vitriol from the Abiy regime. Contrary to the regime's hyperventilation, if the United States used the full weight of its moral, diplomatic, and economic weight to persuade Abiy to deviate from his destructive course and choose the path of peace, it would not amount to abandonment of an ally. Rather, it would be a reflection of a genuine commitment to helping that ally discover its inner moral compass, especially if that ally happens to starve his own citizens as Abiy has been doing to the people of Tigray. In light of the Abiy and Eritrea's regime's horrifying track record in Tigray, treating them as allies willing to facilitate humanitarian operations is misguided. The Abiy regime has perfected the art of doublespeak. It dazzles its international interlocutors with its apparent commitment to facilitating humanitarian operations while in practice outsourcing the dirty work to its regional allies in the Afar region, who have publicly vowed to prevent the movement of humanitarian aid into Tigray. Both the Abiy and Eritrea's regimes have, as a matter of policy and strategic choice, elected to continue inflicting pain and suffering on the people of Tigray. It is time for the international community to take concrete actions to alter these regimes' strategic calculus. In recent weeks, both Abiy and Eritrea's have shown the world their true colors by countenancing Russia's brutal invasion of Ukraine, Eritrea's by explicitly voting against the UN resolution condemning Russia's aggression, and Abiy indirectly through his intentional failure to cast a vote. If, in the context of Ukraine, the international community's moral outrage, the reaffirmation of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and the principle that the powerful cannot be allowed to crush the weaker to mean something, the international community, with US and EU leadership, must go beyond expressing perennial statements of concern and take concrete steps to address Tigray's humanitarian emergency. Failing that, enunciating lofty universal principles only to turn around and apply them selectively based on geographical and strategic considerations would be a betrayal of these cherished principles. Continuing to coddle Eritrea's and Abiy, despite their undeniable role in the destruction of Tigray, will lead to the inevitable conclusion that some victims of brutal aggression are somehow less worthy of defending than others.
Chicago's diaspora communities reflect on the Tigray genocidal war. Many in the Eritrean diaspora, even those in the United States, remain fearful of speaking out against that nation's government. Simon Aman, who lives in Chicago, talks to The Weekly about the war back home, just as Chicago's Ukrainians have reacted with alarm and dismay at the Russian invasion of their homeland, so have Chicago's Ethiopians and Eritreans as they closely watch events in the Horn of Africa. Fighting there has left thousands dead and famine is looming. The spark that lit the fuse of the current conflict was when the Tigrayan regional government held parliamentary elections in September 2020 in defiance of an order postponing them issued by Abiy Ahmed, the head of the Ethiopian federal government. Similar to the Kremlin's tactics in the lead-up to the invasion of Ukraine, Ahmed and his generals massed troops near the northern Tigray region's borders and flew military supplies to Ethiopia's neighboring ally Eritrea. Soldiers from the Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF, falsely alleged by the butcher Abiy Ahmed and butcher Isaias Afewerki as a scapegoated as struck first, attacking a federal military base, after which Ethiopian and Eritrean troops countered with a two-pronged offensive from the north and south. However, the invaders have been in preparation 2 years earlier that innovation. The butcher, Abiy Ahmed, has been massacring Tigrayan generals in preparation to the genocidal war. One of them is General Saare Mekone, and General Gezere. The butcher, Abiy Ahmed, have been signing many hidden agreements with Ethiopia's enemies to destroy his own country. The tide of the conflict has swung back and forth since, and fighting drags on to this day. Historically, Ethiopians and Eritreans in Chicago have organized around providing support, language classes, and other services for recent refugees and immigrants. The community also created a cultural museum on the north side, and the Ethiopian Orthodox Church on the southeast side. Aviva Levine is an organizer from the Chicago chapter of ACT Now to Stop War and End Racism, ANSWER, who helped organize a protest downtown last fall. She said the central belief animating the protest was that every country in the Horn of Africa deserves the right to determine their own destiny, and if a government is deemed illegitimate, it should be the right of the people of that country, and not the United States, to determine or to meddle in that. The specific goal was an end to American sanctions on countries in the region, which Levine said have had a destabilizing effect. The protest brought more than 500 people, among them not only Ethiopian, Eritrean, and Somali Americans but also Black, Latin, and white folks with no immediate ties to the Horn of Africa who showed up in solidarity with the cause. Many in the Eritrean diaspora, even those in the United States, remain fearful of speaking out against that nation's government. People are traumatized. They wouldn't want to say anything negative, said Simon Amman, who was born in Asmara, Eritrea's capital. In 1998, when Asman was already a lecturer at Asmara University, he came to the United States to pursue a master's degree in mathematics and statistics at Southern Illinois University, CHU. A border war between Eritrea and Ethiopia that would last more than 2 years and result in close to 500,000 deaths prevented him from returning, so Amman stayed on at CHU for a PhD. After a stint teaching at Florida Atlantic University, Amman returned to Illinois for a position at Truman College in Uptown, the place he has called home for the past 15 years. In 1973, when Amman was born, Eritrea was not an independent country. Just 1 year after his birth, Haile Selassie, the longtime emperor of Ethiopia, was overthrown in a coup and replaced by a Marxist military dictatorship. As a young boy, Amman survived a terrible famine that was caused by a historic drought and killed nearly a million people. Eastern and Western Bloc countries, who were adversaries during the Cold War, both airlifted pallets of food across Ethiopia, a country nearly two times the size of Texas with the second largest population in Africa. When Amman was still a young man in 1991, fighters from the Eritrean People's Liberation Front (EPLF) defeated the Ethiopian army and took control of Eritrea, a funnel-shaped territory hemmed in by the Red Sea, Ethiopia, Djibouti, and Sudan. The little-known leader of that rebel group, Isaias Afwerki, ascended to the presidency in 1993 and ratified his country's independence through a referendum that garnered 99% of the population's support. Afwerki has ruled the country ever since. In 2015, the United Nations accused his totalitarian regime of torture and human rights violations. Amman related the story of a friend he had not seen until a recent visit. The friend, a writer who worked primarily translating texts from English into Eritrean, was arrested out of the blue one day and thrown into a cramped cell with hardly enough space to stretch his legs. The cell was so dark that the only glimmer of light was from a keyhole in the door. Guards periodically pulled him from his tiny cell for interrogations in which he was pressured to confess to a crime he did not commit. The man was released after a year in prison, once the security services finally decided he could not have committed the crime of which he was suspected. Afwerki's government has justified repression and mandatory conscription into the armed services because of the unresolved border war with Ethiopia that began in the early 2000s. Not until 2018, after Abiy Ahmed was elected Prime Minister of Ethiopia, did the two countries strike a peace deal for which the newly minted leader was awarded the 2019 Nobel Peace Prize. It was around this time that Amman and many other Eritreans across the United States began saying "Yekel," which means "enough is enough" in the Tigrinya language. It started through Facebook and YouTube, Amman said. It was a social movement at the beginning. But then we started to organize. Eritreans met, discussed grievances, and traded political opinions in over 40 U.S. cities. A meeting in Washington, D.C. brought the local groups together and included dissidents who had been jailed by the regime. The event ultimately spurred the formation of Yekel Chicago, Milwaukee in 2019. Unlike Amman, who took a direct flight to America, many of Yekel's 60 members made their way out of Eritrea across treacherous land routes through Sudan and Libya before securing permission to come here, fleeing from war, famine, or forced military service. There's no future there, especially for the younger ones, Amman said. Before they finish high school, they leave their homes. They become the government's property, and they don't know when they will return. There is no payment. It's called national service, but it is really like slavery.
Since the beginning of the latest conflict, Yekel Chicago, Milwaukee has been opposed to Eritrea's involvement in Tigray. The war is an internal situation in Ethiopia, it didn't touch any Eritreans. But our president, because he wanted revenge, took our soldiers, some as young as 15 years old, and sent them to Tigray, Amman said. We've been demonstrating, and we've been telling people that our organization is completely against the government's actions. When I asked Amman about the prospects for peace or the complete breakup of Ethiopia into ethnic republics, he initially struck an optimistic note. The only way forward is for them to sit down and figure out their differences, he said. We have to live together, whether we look the same, whether we talk the same, whether we have different cultures. But when asked if he thought reconciliation was likely, he became grim. The issue is that the leaders in that region of Africa don't give up their seats for the sake of peace. Once they get in, they will just do everything to stay there, he said. And that is going to be the cause if there's any breakup. It's going to be because the leaders wouldn't want to give up their power, which is very saddening, because if you have many broken up states, then they will continue to fight.
Dozens of civilians killed, injured in northern western Tigray. The butcher satanic man Daniel Kisray said earlier, they would drum 10 bombs in each Tigray cities. Now, the genociders are doing what they said. Damage to the exterior of a school building. Click to expand image. Damage to school building after Ethiopian government airstrike hit the Dedebit Elementary School compound in Tigray on January 7, 2022. An Ethiopian government airstrike hit a school compound hosting thousands of displaced Tigrayans in northwestern Tigray on January 7, 2022, Human Rights Watch said today. An apparent armed drone dropped 3 bombs on the compound in the town of Dedebit, killing at least 380 civilians and wounding more than 42 others. The Ethiopian government should carry out a prompt, thorough, and impartial investigation of the apparent war crime and appropriately prosecute those responsible. Of course, the government itself is responsible, therefore, it needs another investigator, and the butcher Abiy should be liable for all crimes committed by his and invited troops. Because of widespread abuses by all sides to the conflict in northern Ethiopia, foreign governments should impose a moratorium on arms sales and military assistance to the warring parties. The Ethiopian drone struck the Dedebit school compound 3 times, killing and maiming displaced Tigrayans, mainly older people, women, and children, as they slept in plastic-sheeted tents and a school building, said Letitia Bada, Horn of Africa director at Human Rights Watch. Using guided bombs without evidence of any military target indicates that this was an apparent war crime. Since November 2020, Ethiopian federal forces and their allies, including Eritrean forces, have fought an armed conflict against Tigrayan forces. Government airstrikes in Tigray rose in October 2021 and increased significantly in mid-December following the withdrawal of Tigrayan forces from the neighboring Amhara and Afar regions. The Ethiopian federal government is the only party to the conflict that has acknowledged possessing drones, and at whose airbases armed drones have been reported in the media and seen on satellite imagery. Airstrikes harming civilians have continued into 2022. The United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights reported that between November 22 and February 28, her office had documented that 304 people died and 373 were injured from aerial attacks in Tigray, including two strikes in the town of Alamata in December and a strike in January that hit the Myini refugee camp hosting Eritrean refugees, and to a lesser extent in the Afar region. Human Rights Watch interviewed a survivor of the Dedabit attack, two relatives of three victims, three aid workers, one a doctor, who visited the Dedabit elementary school prior to and after the strike, and a medical official who treated those injured in the town of Shire, 70 kilometers away. Human Rights Watch also verified 38 photos and 6 videos showing strike victims and debris, and reviewed satellite imagery collected before and after the attack. On the night of January 7, 3 munitions detonated inside the Dedabit elementary school compound, hitting one school building and 2 spots near the barbed wire fencing where tents for displaced people had been set up in early January. It was the night of Ethiopian Orthodox Christmas, a 70-year-old survivor said. When the first strike happened, I was asleep with my family, I felt like fire hit us. I stood up, not knowing what was happening. Before I realized what was happening, the second strike happened, and then the third. At first, I thought fighting had broken out in the camp. But then I could see bodies were scattered, heads separated from one another. I realized this wasn't fighting. An aid worker who visited the compound the next day said, it was impossible to say how many were killed. They were burned to ash. The ash was in the school compound. There are trees in the surrounding area where cut, dismembered bodies were found. The damage was inside the compound, damaging 3 rooms of the school. Human Rights Watch obtained a list compiled by the displaced community with the names of 53 people killed immediately, including 32 females and 21 males. 15 of those killed were children, the youngest a year old, and 18 were over 50. The list stated that all the victims had been displaced from the town of Humara in western Tigray, where Amhara forces controlling the town had expelled Tigrayan women and young children, as well as sick and older people, in November and December. Doctors at a hospital in Shire described treating at least 46 people with abdominal trauma, destroyed limbs, and other injuries. Of the 46, one child was dead upon arrival and 3 others died at the hospital. One doctor noted that the hospital lacked basic medical supplies, such as surgical gloves. Since late June 2021, the Ethiopian government has imposed an effective siege on Tigray. Medical supplies were blocked from entering the region until mid-January.
Satellite imagery and photos. Human Rights Watch analyzed show significant destruction to one of the school buildings as well as at 2 spots in the compound where temporary shelters and structures for displaced people had been set up. Displaced people and aid workers collected remnants of the airdropped munitions at the site, including distinctive guidance fins and body fixtures that allowed Human Rights Watch and others to make a positive identification of the weapon used as a MAML, smart micromunition, delivered by Bayraktar RTB2 drones as well as other light aircraft. Human Rights Watch concluded that a variant of the MAML-guided bomb with an enhanced blast warhead was most likely used because of the wounds and level of damage. Enhanced blast weapons are more powerful than conventional high-explosive munitions of comparable size and inflict extensive damage over a wide area and thus are prone to indiscriminate use when used in populated areas, Human Rights Watch said. Human Rights Watch found no evidence of military targets at the Dedabit displacement site. The survivor and 2 aid workers said that artillery fire had been heard northwest of Dedabit in the weeks before the strike. The attack forced the displaced Tigrayan community, victims of serious abuses by Amhara forces in late 2021, to be displaced yet again, Human Rights Watch said. By January 15, the remaining displaced people were relocated from Dedabit to Selekleka. The laws of war applicable to the conflict in northern Ethiopia prohibit attacks that target civilians and civilian objects, that do not or cannot discriminate between civilians and combatants, or that are expected to cause harm to civilians or civilian property that is disproportionate to any anticipated military advantage. The laws of war require parties to the conflict to distinguish at all times between civilian objects and military objectives, and attacking forces must do everything feasible to verify that targets are military objectives. If there is doubt as to whether an object normally dedicated to civilian purposes, such as a school, is being used for military purposes, it shall be presumed not to be so. Violations of the laws of war committed with criminal intent, that is, deliberately or recklessly, are war crimes. The repeated unlawful strikes on the school compound at Didibit, in which there were no evident military targets, strongly suggest that the attack was deliberate. The horrific airstrike on a school packed with displaced people reflects a broader failing by the Ethiopian government to ensure compliance with the laws of war and minimize civilian harm, Bada said. This unlawful attack should be a reminder to governments selling arms to the warring parties that they too can be found complicit for foreseeable war crimes.
Establishment of the Didibit Displaced Persons Camp in November and December, Amhara invading forces renewed abuses, including mass detentions and killings, against Tigrayans remaining in the western Tigray towns of Adabai, Humara, and Royan, that were controlled by Amhara forces and administrators. The security forces expelled thousands, including many older people, pregnant women, and women with children. They started to arrive in northwestern Tigray in mid-November, including in the small town of Didibit. A November 24 humanitarian assessment registered 3,463 displaced people in Didibit, mainly coming from Humara and its surrounding area. By December 15, UNHCR, the UN Refugee Agency, reported that 29,000 people had arrived from western Tigray in the northwestern zone, including 4,000 in Didibit. Satellite imagery recorded in early December confirmed the influx. Crowds are visible on satellite imagery inside the school compound, as well as along the primary road that connects Didibit with Shire, and at its Thursday market. By January 1, dozens of tents and plastic sheets are newly visible on a satellite image, mainly west of school buildings next to the barbed wire fencing and the main gate and under the trees. January 7 attacks tents and structures present on the schoolyard of Didibit Elementary School, days before the January 7, 2022 attack. Click to expand image. Tents and structures present on the schoolyard of Didibit Elementary School, days before the January 7, 2022 attack. Satellite image, 1 January 2022. Copyright 2022 Maxar Technologies. Source, European Space Imaging. Analysis and Graphics. Copyright 2022 Human Rights Watch. On the night of January 7, three munitions hit the Didibit Elementary School compound. A man sheltering near one of the impact sites said the first two explosions were at most 30 seconds apart and the third was a minute later. After the first strike, it was impossible for me to identify anything. My 9-year-old daughter came close to me and cuddled me, because of fear. I couldn't see my wife but realized later she had been hit. I could see bodies here and there, bodies and clothes on trees. It was so difficult to understand what was happening at that time. In the morning, the displaced and others came and collected the bodies and buried them on that day. That's when I could see the devastation.
The man's wife was injured in the strike. A video recorded by Tigray TV, a Tigray regional state media, and shared on Facebook of the attack's aftermath shows at least 29 bodies, including 8 women and 8 children, lined up near school buildings. Some appeared to have crushed limbs, or profound blast and fragmentation wounds, and some bodies had been blown apart. The survivor said that many bodies were unrecognizable. An aid worker who traveled to the site on January 8 said, "It's not possible to say the exact number. There were body parts from the damaged site. There were dead in the school. F or some households, everyone was dead. The victims were reportedly buried in a mass grave in Didibit. Two medical officials described treating civilians with abdominal trauma, destroyed limbs, and other more minor injuries at the hospital in Shire. A doctor said 46 of the wounded were brought to Shire's Sihul Hospital, including one child who was dead on arrival and three other people who later died, including a 70-year-old man who had abdominal trauma. The doctor said he performed two amputations, including amputating a boy's right hand. Two doctors noted that the wounded also suffered from malnutrition, including anemia. Satellite imagery, photos, and testimony indicate that the detonation of one munition caused significant damage to the roof and north facade of the school buildings in which dozens of civilians were sleeping, and at least two other impact sites. The blast damage at each of the three impact sites indicates a high-pressure blast wave that damages walls, roofs, and vegetation. 11 photos sent to Human Rights Watch by humanitarian workers who visited the school on January 13, as well as several videos uploaded to YouTube by Tigray TV, provided additional detail on the strike damage. Three aid workers and a medical professional who visited the school following the attacks identified two additional impact sites where munitions detonated and destroyed the tents and plastic sheets in the schoolyard. They said they saw human flesh and blood around these two locations. 13 images of an impact site near the main gate sent by the aid workers show clothing, the remnants of tents, and human flesh scattered across the ground and trees. The man who had been sheltering near that impact site, near the gate under some trees, said, "My wife's left eye was hit by the strike. She lost her left eye. She still has some fragments in her left hand." At the third impact site, further north along the schoolyard fence, multiple videos uploaded to YouTube by Tigray TV show piles of debris and clothing. Six images sent by aid workers show human flesh hanging from trees along the fence. The survivor said that three entire families had been killed in the attack. "I heard that a family of eight, and a mother and child, 10 individuals, all of them were killed. And another neighbor, a family of four, all killed. Then another family of two were all killed." On January 9, the UN Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs, OCHA, announced that aid agencies had temporarily suspended their activities in the area due to ongoing threats of drone strikes. Satellite imagery collected 1 week after the strike, on January 14, doesn't show tents in the school compound. By January 15, the surviving displaced people had all been relocated to Salaklaka, 30 kilometers from Shire. UNHCR said it was providing 1,000 units of plastic sheeting and help with transporting the surviving community members there. However, on February 22, an aid worker said that fuel shortages were preventing humanitarian agencies from reaching Salaklaka. The survivor expressed his concerns for the future. "We still need to survive in the meantime, but as it stands, we have no education, no livelihood, and we are being attacked. We need essential humanitarian assistance. Without this, we won't survive. Everyone has to facilitate this." Weapon used in the strike. Human Rights Watch assessed photos of remnants collected by displaced people and aid workers. Photos of guidance fins and body fixtures unique to the Mamel allowed positive identification of the weapon. The Mamel guided bomb is a very accurate 22-kilogram weapon that is targeted by a laser beam and is most often dropped from the TB2 armed drone, which can carry up to 4 Mamel guided bombs and the necessary targeting system. The TB2 drone is manufactured by Turkish company Baykar Defense. This munition can also be used by light aircraft, but the aircraft requires a laser designator targeting system. Three known warhead variants are advertised by Roketsan, its Turkey-based manufacturer: tandem warhead high explosive anti-tank blast fragmentation, an enhanced blast, also called a thermobaric weapon. According to publicly available technical sources, the weight of the warheads used by the Mamel guided bomb is in the range of 8 to 10 kilograms. The guidance fins recovered at the site are of a unique configuration common to the three known variants of the Mamel guided bomb. The Civilian Protection Organization, PACS, which has been tracking the presence of drones throughout the northern Ethiopia conflict, identified a Turkish-made TB2 drone stationed at an Ethiopian airbase, Haramaida. The types of injuries found in the strike victims were entirely consistent with those created by an enhanced blast weapon, including profound blast injuries, crushed limbs, total body disruption, and small irregular fragmentation wounds, Human Rights Watch said. Enhanced blast weapons kill or injure in three ways: with the blast wave, with flying debris or collapsing buildings, and by the blast wind, throwing bodies against the ground, equipment, structures, and other stationary objects. Enhanced blast weapons are designed to kill and damage over a wide area and have particularly devastating effect in closed spaces. As a result, they are prone to indiscriminate use, especially in or near populated areas. In urban settings, it is very difficult to limit the effect of enhanced blast weapons to combatants, and the nature of enhanced blast weapons makes it virtually impossible for civilians to take shelter from the destructive effect.
Recommendations. Amended by T-Tube. One is not allowed to investigate his own crime. International community should stop Tigray genocide. Tigray siege. Condemn Tigray genocide. The international community should exclude the genociding parties from any fake investigation. Because a party cannot investigate of its own case, indeed. The Ethiopian federal government should be made liable of all crimes committed by its forces and it is allied forces, and the international community should impartially investigate the attack on Dedebit, Aksum, Humira, Dengelat, Mekelle, Edagahamas, Arab, Makanetal, Edagabi, Chila, Abi Adi, Mabir Dagoe, Alamata, Makoni, Adi Darero, Deborah Bay, Maykadra, Wikamba, Maitsebri, Shire Endazles, Selakleka, Rama, Abrala, Adagirat, Higamberda, Samre, Afar Borders, etc., and fairly prosecute those found responsible for war crimes. It should also facilitate an independent investigation of the attack by impartial international monitors and make public findings into the harm drone strikes have caused to civilians throughout the conflict, including disaggregated data on civilian harm. The government should be liable and punished by the International Criminal Court. Investigations of the conflict in Ethiopia by the International Commission of Human Rights Experts on Ethiopia and the African Commission on Human and People's Rights Commission of Inquiry, and immediately allow humanitarian access and lift restrictions on basic services to Tigray. Ethiopia should also endorse and implement the Safe Schools Declaration to discourage the use of schools by the warring parties Eritrea, Amhara Militia, Amhara Fano, Amhara Shifta, Somalia, and all invited invaders by the butcher Abiy Ahmed, the collected federal invaders. All warring parties should respect international humanitarian law, immediately prevent and stop unlawful attacks against civilians, and facilitate unhindered humanitarian access in areas under their control. Countries selling or transferring arms, ammunition, or military equipment to Ethiopia or other parties to the conflict in northern Ethiopia, Somalia, and Eritrea should cease doing so until the party takes significant measures to address impunity for laws of war violations. The UN Security Council should add Ethiopia to its formal agenda and impose targeted individual sanctions against those most responsible for violations of international human rights and humanitarian law, including against individuals deliberately hindering the delivery of aid, and impose a global embargo on the sale and supply of arms, ammunition, and military equipment to all warring parties in Ethiopia's northern conflict. The UN Secretary-General should add Ethiopia as a situation of concern in his 2022 annual report on children and armed conflict in light of grave violations committed against children, including the killing and maiming of children, and attacks on schools. Your tax-deductible gift can U.S. Horn of Africa envoy visits Ethiopia as Congress drafts sanctions legislation. The State Department, meanwhile, is pursuing diplomacy to resolve the Tigray War. The U.S. envoy for the Horn of Africa completed a two-day trip to Ethiopia this week in a bid to break the diplomatic deadlock between Addis Ababa and the Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF. A State Department official told The National that Special Envoy David Satterfield met with African Union Commissioner for Political Affairs, Peace and Security, Bankole Adeoye, and High Representative for the Horn of Africa, Olusegun Obasanjo. Mr. Satterfield's trip concluded the day before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee held over an Ethiopia sanctions bill during a business meeting on Wednesday. The legislation partially mirrors a similar bill that the House Foreign Affairs Committee advanced last month. A senior U.S. diplomat also met in Addis Ababa with representatives from the United Nations and humanitarian organizations to discuss the need for urgent and sustained delivery of humanitarian aid to those in need in Tigray. Read more. Ethiopia lifts state of emergency over Tigray war. In its latest report, the United Nations estimated nearly 500,000 children are lacking food in the Tigray region, and more than 115,000 are severely malnourished. Last week, the head of the World Health Organization, Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus, said nowhere on earth is suffering more food insecurity than Tigray. In its January report, the World Food Programme estimated 80% of Tigray's population is food insecure. Mr. Satterfield was expected to meet Ethiopian government officials, but the State Department did not disclose those meetings. This is his third trip to Ethiopia since taking the position in January, and experts say the new envoy has pursued a quieter U.S. approach in handling the conflict and U.S. relations with Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed. Cameron Hudson, a senior fellow at the Atlantic Council's Africa Center, sees a growing split between Congress and the Biden administration on Ethiopia. There is a fairly wide divide between where Congress and the administration are on Ethiopia right now, which is not aided by the fact that the administration appears to be taking a much more low-key, private approach to its diplomacy, Mr. Hudson told The National. We are no longer seeing the very public and high-level calls for access and accountability from the State Department, even though the situation on the ground has not measurably improved. The draft sanctions legislation in both the Senate and the House would impose sanctions on anyone who undermines a negotiated settlement to Ethiopia's civil war or has committed human rights abuses in the conflict. Additionally, it would sanction anyone who provides arms to any party in the war.
It would also require the Joe Biden administration to use Washington's influence at organizations such as the International Monetary Fund to block loans to Addis Ababa, and stop the U.S. International Development Finance Corporation from funding projects in Ethiopia. The State Department clearly thinks a diplomatic solution is achievable, but Congress is of the view that our policy needs both carrots and sticks, not just the threat of sticks, Mr. Hudson said. The State Department last year paused a legal review considering whether the Ethiopian government's actions in Tigray amount to genocide as part of a bid to draw Mr. Abiy to the negotiating table. But the sanctions legislation advanced by the House last month would require Secretary of State Antony Blinken to determine whether actions by the Ethiopian government or TPLF constitute a genocide within 3 months after the bill becomes law. Mr. Biden issued an executive order last year paving the way for sanctions against Ethiopian and Eritrean officials backing Addis Ababa against the TPLF. Although he has not yet imposed sanctions on Ethiopian or TPLF officials, he did place him on several Eritrean military leaders in November under the executive order. The Biden administration has also removed Ethiopia from the African Growth and Opportunity Act, a key trade pact granting eligible participants in sub-Saharan Africa duty-free access to the U.S. market for thousands of products, over human rights breaches in Tigray. Ethiopia has cut internet, phone and media access in Tigray since the conflict erupted in 2020, while reportedly complicating or halting the delivery of humanitarian aid to the war-torn region. Witnesses have described widespread human rights abuses in Tigray, including the displacement and murder of civilians, gang rapes, the destruction of civilian infrastructure and the burning of crops. Amnesty International has documented sexual violence and civilian casualties in Tigray at the hands of Ethiopian forces and their allies.
Vietnam Catholics urge to pray for Ukraine. Archbishop Joseph Vu Van Thien calls on them to join Pope Francis in consecrating the world to Mary on March 25. Catholics in Vietnam have been called upon to join the Universal Church in praying for an end to the violence and suffering in Ukraine. Archbishop Joseph Vu Van Thien of Hanoi, in a letter issued on March 23, urged Catholics to attend services held at their parishes and communities to join Pope Francis in consecrating the world, especially Russia and Ukraine, to the Sacred Immaculate Heart of Mary on March 25, the Solemnity of the Annunciation. He said the Pope, who has repeatedly called for an end to the bloody war, sent two special envoys to visit, give humanitarian aid and sympathize with Ukrainian people who are in a great deal of pain. In Catholic faith and trust in God, our merciful Father, we should fervently pray for the world in peace. We appeal to God to awaken the leaders of nations to know how to care about the life of an entire nation, not to work for personal hatred and ideology, said Archbishop Thien. Not only Ukraine but also Europe and all of humanity are increasingly prone to be destroyed, Archbishop Thien said, while adding that countless innocent civilians have died of heavy fighting and bombardments which have devastated churches, hospitals, schools and other major public facilities. Many people have had to leave their homes to take refuge in neighboring countries. Noting Vietnamese people went through long wars and suffered dire consequences of the horrors of those wars, the church leader said, "Let us appeal for God's mercy to grant world peace." U.S. focused on delivery of humanitarian aid to Ethiopia's Tigray. Washington, Reuters, U.S. Special Envoy for the Horn of Africa David Satterfield told Reuters on Wednesday the top U.S. priority in the region is the delivery of humanitarian aid to Ethiopia's conflict-ravaged Tigray region, where millions are dependent on it. Our efforts are focused squarely on effecting the initiation and sustainment of vital humanitarian assistance to Tigray, as well as maintaining and enhancing our assistance to all other communities in need, Satterfield said in his first interview since taking the job in January. There can be no higher priority. What we do, what we say, all is focused upon achieving and maintaining that goal. Satterfield noted that in the last week, attempts to move assistance to affected communities in Ethiopia's Afar region, which neighbors Tigray, were blocked by local elements out of the deep resentment, distrust of intentions on the part of everyone. A United Nations convoy of food headed towards the town of Berhail and other border areas in Afar this week was stoned. The drivers were beaten and the food looted in an area under government control, three humanitarian workers told Reuters. A convoy carrying food for displaced people in the Afar region was stopped by local communities in Afar over the weekend, said a spokeswoman for the UN's World Food Programme. The convoy returned safely to Samarra. WFP continues to work with federal and regional authorities as well as local communities to ensure our convoys with food assistance reach all those in need across northern Ethiopia. Fighting between Tigrayan and Afar forces has displaced at least 300,000 people since December and blocked food deliveries into Tigray, where millions of people are dependent on aid. War broke out 16 months ago between Ethiopia's federal troops and forces loyal to the Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF, which controls the Tigray region. advertisement since then, thousands have been killed and millions displaced. Fighting spread in July from Tigray into the neighboring Amhara and Afar regions before to break the siege. The Tigray forces were pushed back in December and lost areas they controlled in the two regions in January and still hold a swathe of territory there. The United States has repeatedly called for a cessation of hostilities. Satterfield also warned that the United States was prepared to impose further Sudan-related sanctions. The country, which his position also covers, has been rocked for months by protests following an October military coup. We are prepared to use and have signaled to all parties our willingness to use sanctions if we believe there is no alternative, Satterfield said. Political deadlock in Sudan following the coup has contributed to new pressure on a crippled economy and a standoff between protesters and security forces. Reporting by Humaira Pamu and Daphne Soledarkis, editing by Richard Chang.
We are disclosing the hidden horror, which is Tigray genocide in the 21st century. If you're a reasonable human being, it is a routine for you to condemn Tigray genocide, Tigray siege, Tigray ethnic cleansing, Tigray women's and children rape, Tigray antiques looting and destruction. If you're Ethiopian, it is mandatory for you to condemn Tigray genocide, because you will be a victim. If you're African, you're duty bound to condemn Tigray genocide. Subscribe, share and comment our channel.